Well, good evening. Once again, it's a privilege to welcome you all along to this, our evening service. And obviously, if you're a visitor, I don't see any visitors. No, there's no visitors. But even if you'd been a visitor, we'd give you a very warm welcome. And obviously, those that are listening later on in the week, we give you a very warm welcome. And to those that are listening on YouTube, the same welcome. And it is a privilege to be up here, to be able to welcome you all here. As I was saying this morning, it's a lovely fellowship, this. I really love being here. And I often use this phrase to a lot of people, that God doesn't make mistakes. And he hasn't made a mistake having me and Alan back here in Lossie Mouth worshiping with us, the fellowship here. As we've been doing really on since about 2002, when we were coming up weekends. So it is a joy to be here and to join together in the worship and praise of Almighty God. A few notices from the bulletin that we mentioned this morning. We'll mention them again tonight. The service times for the morning services will change to 10:30 on Sunday, the 30th of October. That's the weekend that the clocks change. Don't be late. And Liam Morton will be taking up his post as associate pastor starting on Monday, the 7th of November. As I said again this morning, if it's a fellowship, we would remember Liam and Deandra in prayer, because it is a big move for them. They're leaving familiar surroundings and moving up here to Lossie Mouth. Mind you, I'd rather live in Lossie Mouth than the Central Belt anyway, and I'm sure they'll reflect the same feelings once they get moved up here. But pray, I mean, there is quite a number of issues that need to be overcome for them coming up here, housing and moving, just all that kind of thing. So pray for them as a fellowship. We mentioned to you this morning the Tesco Community Grants Scheme. Blue tokens, if you shop in Tesco, blue tokens, a handful of you go at the same lady that I was at this morning, and maybe just one or two if it's a different person, I don't know, and put them in the box saying, Lossie Mouth Baptist Church. For the little acorns. The men's fellowships, there's a wrong date in the one for the golf, the first one on the 22nd of October, not the 27th, at 9:30. And if you wish to go, put your name on the board. We usually have a good bit of fun. We have breakfast and all, and it's all about the fellowship and the breakfast. It's nothing to do with the golf, because unless you're maybe George Campbell or somebody like that, you were never very good at golf. We just hit the ball. So anyway, if you're a gentleman and you want to go along, then put your name on the sheet. And the fire alarm test will now be tested on the 23rd of October following the service. So that day there'll be no tea and coffee following on from the service. I think that's everything that needed to be highlighted. I'd like to read a part of Psalm 9, just to start this off. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. When my enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before your presence. For you've maintained my just cause. You have sat on the throne, giving righteous judgment. You have rebuked the nations. You have made the wicked perish. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. The enemy came to an end in everlasting ruins. Their cities you rooted out. The very memory of them has perished. But the Lord sits enthroned forever. He has established his throne for justice. And he judges the world with righteousness. He judges the peoples with uprightness. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you again that we can come to this place of worship. And Father, even as I read that psalm, I was thinking about what an awesome God you are. There's no one like you. Even when we were praying through the bark just now, Father, we were thinking about just what a compassionate and generous God you were. That's the theme of this morning's sermon, Father, a compassionate and a generous God, Father. And we just thank you for your compassion towards each and every one of us. Father, nothing that in our time with you, Father, is down to anything that we have done. It's all about what you have done for us in the giving of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father. And so we praise you tonight, and so we thank you tonight. We thank you, Father, that we can be found in Christ. We thank you, Father, that we can be found in this place, worshiping and praising you. We thank you again, Father, as we often do, that we can come to this place unaccosted, Father. We can come here in complete freedom, and we just thank you for that, Father. We thank you that we can come and praise a holy God. And Father, as a fellowship here this evening, we want to praise you for just for the fellowship that we have here, for the love and for the welcome that's often expressed in this place, Father. The amount of people that you over the years, Father, have come up here and given their testimony, particularly at baptisms and things like that, Father, have just said that I've just rejoiced in the fellowship and the welcome and the love that's been expressed in this place. And we just pray that we would continue to be a fellowship like that, a fellowship of welcome, a fellowship of love. And Father, we again just thank you for our Pastor Rab, Lord, and we thank you for the way that you anointed his ministry this morning. In fact, the way that you anoint his ministry week after week. We thank you, Father, for him. We thank you that for the time that he spends in the quiet place before the throne of grace, seeking your face, Lord. And we just thank you that in blessing him, you bless each and every one of us. And so, Father, now we just ask again that by your Holy Spirit, you would indeed presence yourself with us, that each person that is gathered here tonight would know a touch from the Lord God himself, Father. For we ask it in Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to have three songs before Rab comes to bring the word to us. I'm going to get emotional again. Just too much. He is exalted. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. Let's all stand together. Thank you.
to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, reign in me. Over all the earth.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky.
Well, good evening, and it's good to be together, and thank you guys for leading us in worship together. We're continuing our series we began last week in Abraham, in Genesis, and we come this evening to our second installment in the series, having looked last week at his incredible faith, Abraham's incredible faith, a man who is worth celebrating for the fact that he had such confidence in God's word. Later on in Joshua 24, as he looks back on this, Joshua 24 tells us that Terah, the father of Abraham, served other gods. And yet Abraham listened to the voice of God, which called for him to go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. We saw last week that Abraham got up and went based on nothing except the promise from God, which really was all that Abraham needed. promise was from God that he would make of Abraham a great nation and would bless him and make his name great so that he would be a blessing. And there'd be lots of reasons, and there was lots of reasons, for Abraham to come to a place where he said, "Are you sure, me, God? Are you really sure about that? Because me and my wife have been trying for many years to have children. We haven't had any children. We're long in our years, at least 75 for Abraham." And yet, based on those promises alone, Abraham got up. And as the Hebrew writer recognizes in Hebrew 11, he says, "By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going." Hebrews 11, verse 8. And although we really only had time to look at the first three verses of chapter 12, and that took up really all of our time, we read on last week to hear that Abraham arrived in the promised land, currently occupied by the Canaanites, and the Lord appeared to Abraham in verse 7 and said, "To your offspring I will give you this land." And Abraham, in response to this great promise, built an altar to the Lord as a response of worship. Here was Abraham, in contrast to his father Terah, worshipping the one true God, and in doing so he was rejecting the false gods of his father. We don't know to what extent Abraham ever followed the same gods or not, but this is a very clear moment as he builds an altar that he's saying, "God, you are my God, and I reject any other gods. You're the one true God that I'm going to listen to and worship and follow after." And so the question comes to us, doesn't it? How do you expect Abraham's life to continue as we continue reading in chapter 12? How do you expect the father of the nation of Israel to act after this great act of faith and worship? After all, Abraham isn't just any man. God made a very unique promise with him, a promise which became a covenant, which would be the inheritance to all who believe in the name of the Lord, including us today. Even today in the church, we inherit a belonging to God that was birthed in with Abraham and completed ultimately in Christ. Now, with him starting so well, if we were to not know the story of Genesis and how it unfolds, we'd probably say we expect Abraham to go from strength to strength because he's such a man of faith. But of course, that isn't what we're going to see. So let's turn in our Bibles to Acts. I do it on your own time, like, but Genesis 12, beginning at verse 10. "Now there was a famine in the land, and so Abraham went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. When he was about to enter Egypt, he said to Sarai, his wife, 'I know that you're a woman beautiful in appearance. And when the Egyptians see you, they'll say, this is his wife. Then they'll kill me, but they'll let you live. Say you are my sister, that it may go well with me because of you, and that by my life may be spared for your sake.' When Abraham entered Egypt, the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. And when the princes of Pharaoh saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh. And the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. And for her sake, he dealt well with Abraham. And he had sheep, oxen, male donkeys, male servants, female servants, male donkeys, and camels." Female donkeys. "But the Lord afflicted Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abraham's wife. So Pharaoh called Abraham and said, 'What is this that you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister? So I took her for my wife. Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go.' And Pharaoh gave men orders concerning him, and they sent him away with his wife and all that he had." Amen. God's word to us this evening. Let's pray as we come to his beautiful word. Our Lord and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We pray that we would never come to a place where we don't appreciate the fact that you have chosen to speak to us predominantly through your word, authoritatively through your word. That though it doesn't tell us every single thing that we can know, it tells us everything that we need to know. And if anything isn't said or worked out here in this book, then it's not worth knowing for our salvation. We pray as we come to this particular passage in Abraham's life that you would help us to see salvation a little clearer, to learn how we can trust in you a little bit more. And Lord, that you would help us become the kind of people who are renowned for a faith like Abraham, but trust in you in all circumstances. We pray these things in your precious name, for these things come from you and you alone, and we seek you for our guidance and our strength. In your name, amen. So our portion of scripture this evening is one covered in human fear. It's quite understandable in one sense, and actually reveals a contradiction to what we've just seen last week in Abraham. Abraham isn't admired because he did the most logical thing. He isn't admired because he thinks well on his feet. Abraham is admired for the one reason that he is obedient to God. He leaves the comfort of Haran, which had two large Mesopotamian rivers near it, so largely avoided any experience of famine. And he went to the land that would become Israel. Well, there, verse 12 says, there was a famine in the land, so Abraham went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. Abraham has been obedient to God, and it led him into a famine. And I wonder for a little bit if this is part of the problem for Abraham. I wonder if he thinks that since everything is going perfectly or isn't going perfectly, maybe he's beginning to have some doubts about whether he's doing the right thing. Whatever his thinking is, we can at least recognize that he didn't return home to where he could have gone. And if he'd returned home, he would have gone to where these rivers were, but instead he heads south down to Egypt. Now, in a famine, heading to Egypt was always a good idea because they had the River Nile. And if you know anything about Egypt, you'll know that it became a superpower pretty much because of the River Nile. It's said that the River Nile was more dependable than the rain. That's what the Egyptians used to say and recognize. So this passage doesn't say what Abraham should have done. Should he have stayed in Bethel? Would it have been better for Abraham to stay where he is and let the Lord provide? Or I'm not sure, maybe because of its silence, it's an indication that Abraham didn't check with the Lord. He didn't even take the time to say, Lord, what do you want me to do in this situation that I'm in a famine? We just know he went. And we're certainly going to see that what happens is mostly Abraham's idea, and it's a pretty poor idea. Nothing to do with God. But what's so shocking is what he does towards his wife, Sarah. This is a man who has left all he knew because God made a promise, and Abraham believed the promise. That we know, that we can stand surely on. Remember when we said that Abraham left because he recognized that the one true God was the one who made all things out of nothing. And if God made all things out of nothing, nothing was impossible for him. He could give Abraham and Sarah a child in their old age, and he could certainly protect Abraham from any danger, especially since God had not yet fulfilled his promise. It was like a guarantee that until God had fulfilled his promise, Abraham didn't have to worry about his life in any way, because God always keeps his promises, which certainly Abraham believed when he left Haran. Yet Abraham lacks any sense of trust in God's protection by coming up with this terrible plan. And what's so frustrating, or what's terrible about it, is he comes up with this twice. We're going to see this again. I think it's in 20 that he does it a second time. And his son does it as well. So it's a common theme in Genesis that isn't one that we should ever take as worthy of employing. But anyway, in verse 11, we're told, when Abraham was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife, Sarah, I know that you're a beautiful woman in appearance. Well, it starts with a compliment at least. Did Sarah think, uh-oh, what does this mean? Maybe to Abraham when you hear something polite from her husband. Anyway, it continues, and when the Egyptians see you, they'll say this is his wife. Then they will kill me, but they will let you live. And it does appear that Abraham is right. Verse 14 does say that when Abraham entered Egypt, the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. And when the princes of Pharaoh saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh. And when the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. So Abraham knew Sarah would turn heads, and he sought by others. And this appears to be where Abraham comes up with a plan. And it is a terrible plan. Now, there is some squint logic here. It's interesting when you start reading commentaries and so on. There's a lot of people who want to justify what Abraham was doing, and I don't think you can justify what Abraham did, so let's not even try that part. But there is something kind of a squint logic going on here, maybe. He says in verse 13, say that you're my sister, that it may go well with me because of you, and that my life may be spared. And then, interestingly, I didn't notice this until I was reading it a minute ago, but he actually says that my life may be spared for your sake, which is a very interesting way of approaching it. It's true. The Abraham, the covenant, the promise was made to Abraham. So he's right in one sense. But he's absolutely twisting this to the longest degree that he possibly can here for it. Now, commentators have explained that by Sarah's saying it was Sarah's brother, any suitor would need to go through him if they wanted to marry her. So it might be that Abraham's intention was to actually say that Sarah was his sister and then just refuse anyone who tried to marry her so he could just travel through Egypt as quickly as possible with as little trouble as possible. Now, that is a possibility, and if Abraham's intention was to keep moving quickly, then that might work. But if they're willing to kill him as a husband in order to take Sarah, they'd surely also be willing to kill him as a brother and take Sarah for themselves as well. And so I suppose if his plan was to get through Egypt as quickly as possible, then being a suitor might have worked. But even then, I would say, Abraham, really? This is not going to justify what happened and what took place here. But regardless, if that was a plan, it failed almost very quickly, almost at the beginning, because Pharaoh takes her into his house. And now Abraham is stuck in his lie. And much worse, Sarah is stuck in Pharaoh's household. And Abraham failed Sarah as her husband. Instead of protecting his wife, as he's called to do, caring for her and honoring her and keeping her from harm's way, Abraham has put Sarah into harm's way in order that he might be safe. In a small way, we might say that he sacrifices Sarah so that things might go well for him. It's a terrible move, and it's rooted in a complete lack of faith in the God who would protect Abraham from any harm. Imagine what it must have been like for Abraham when verse 16 says, "For Sarah's sake, Pharaoh dealt well with Abraham, and he had sheep and oxen and male donkeys and male servants and female donkeys and camels." And I hope that Abraham had the decency to feel shame as he received these gifts based on a lie. Poor Sarah found herself trapped in Pharaoh's household, and Abraham would have felt helpless to say anything. His lie had gotten him into deeper trouble. And when you think about it, it's a serious problem. What's at stake here? Surely the promise of God to make a covenant with Abraham, that this promise was to be fulfilled in Sarah as she gave birth to Isaac. But thankfully, in our story, in our true story of Abraham, there is at least a rescuer. But of course, the rescuer isn't Abraham. Look at verse 17, and we'll see the rescue at work. "The Lord afflicted Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abraham's wife." God defends Sarah, because despite Abraham's failure, God's made a covenant with him. And this is a vital characteristic of God. Do you realize, do you know that God keeps his promises even when the other party in the covenant does not keep theirs? In our world, when we think about agreements or contracts, if you break a contract, your contract becomes null and void. If I make a promise to buy a house for X amount of money and I only put up some of that money, I don't get part of the house. The whole contract falls through because I haven't fulfilled that agreement. And in reality, a covenant is a deeper thing than a contract. It offers more than just goods by offering our very selves into the agreement. But a broken covenant would become null and void just the same. And yet, thankfully, God does not treat us this way. God does not nullify his covenant because Abraham has lacked trust in God. He doesn't go looking for someone else and say, "Do you know what, Abraham, you had your chance. I'm now going to go and look for someone else." Instead, God steps in and he defends Sarah, interestingly, with plagues in Egypt, just as he will when it comes time for Moses to set the Hebrews free. But where that Pharaoh with Moses will harden his heart to God, this Pharaoh with Abraham recognizes God's anger and he acts quickly. God shows his disgust with what Abraham has done by punishing Pharaoh for what he's about to do. And it's likely if he had been brought into Pharaoh's household is that she was in a stage where she was probably learning all the cultures and acceptabilities and so on of becoming a concubine. And so God probably most likely does rescue her, but we don't know. The passage is quiet about it. We shouldn't speculate too much. But it seems to me, or I at least like to think when I sleep tonight, that Sarah was rescued in all senses of the way. But all we know is that Pharaoh in this passage becomes more righteous in this situation than Abraham. He's shocked by what Abraham does. Verse 18 says to Abraham, "What is this that you've done to me? Pharaoh, the one who worships false gods, what have you done to me? Why did you tell me that she was your wife? Why didn't you tell me? Why did you say she's my sister so that I took her for my wife? Now then, here's your wife. Take her and go. Pharaoh's disgusted by what Abraham has done to him, and ironically, it's Pharaoh who has the upper hand, and Abraham is the one who's known for his belief, and it counted to him as righteousness, as in a few weeks we'll come to. And yet here it is, it's Pharaoh who's saying, what is this unrighteous thing that you have done, misleading me over your wife? It's Pharaoh who demands Abraham takes his wife and leaves, as he should have done long ago. It's Pharaoh who has a clearer sense of right and wrong and disgust that he's been deceived. But there's no doubt, it's God who intervened and rescued Sarah and Abraham from Egypt. So then, if that's our passage and that's what we're seeing, what can we take away for ourselves this evening? What do we reflect on? First thing I think we need to recognize is our trust in God. Like Abraham, who walked in faithfulness into famine, we need to recognize that Christianity doesn't promise us that we'll never experience difficulties. Do you know, when you read stories of people from Open Doors, and obviously Brother Andrew passed away, I think, two weeks ago, who was the founder of Open Doors. And when you go and you hear the stories of those people, and you think of some of the countries where there really is just a few hundred, maybe sometimes a few thousand believers in an area. And when, you know, ISIS and all these other groups have come in, they almost remove entire Christian witness in those areas. And you look at them and you realize that it would be false to turn to them and say, if you become a Christian, all your troubles will go away. If you follow Jesus, you'll never have a struggle ever again. And I don't think we're too bad at saying that these days, but there were times, wasn't there? And maybe we subtly say it in our testimonies. You know, we talk about how bad our life was before God, and then when we become a Christian, how our life becomes amazing. And that's absolutely true, by the way. But it's deceitfully true if you think it's true because everything goes swimmingly after you become a Christian. That's not the reason why those testimonies are true. The reason those testimonies are true is because Christianity is not a way to escape difficult times. Instead, it is the power by which our difficulties can be faced. You see, the only way to survive as a Christian in these countries where it can cost you your life is to trust God. To trust God that he has things under his control as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And that whatever the cost, even your life, which we say like words here, but in other countries, is a genuine threat. Even if they die, they know it's worth it. And up to that point of death, they recognize that God is always going to be their refuge and their strength. He's the anchor in the storm, holding them firm. I've told you before about this, but a friend of mine I was at school with, he got freaked out when his auntie was dying of cancer. And someone in the family, I can only think stupidly, said to the auntie, how can you believe in God when you're dying of cancer? And she looked him in the eye and said, I don't know how any of these people in this ward can have cancer and not believe in God. He has carried me through this whole experience. And my heart goes out to all those people who have to go through this without God. And you know, it shook the family. The family came back, and this young guy that I was at school with came to see me and said, what is this Christianity thing? Because they're freaking me out. How could she respond that way? How could she respond that way? Because she had a faith in God in the difficult circumstances. She had a recognition that God was her refuge and her strength in her circumstances. And a realization that it would be much more ugly, much harder to live a life without God giving us strength and refuge and hope in these circumstances. Anyway, when these difficulties come, they can often come where we have to make a choice. Trust God and stay true to his promises, or try to solve the problems ourselves by manipulating the truth or trying to create the right circumstances, or where we decide that the end justifies the means and so by any means necessary. There's times in our workplace we've got to make a decision. Okay, we're asked to do something that you know would not please the Lord. We have to make a choice in those moments. There are times when we have opportunities and we know it might not be well received if we take the chance when someone says, "Ah, what is wrong with this world?" And you feel prompted to say, "Can I tell you what's wrong with this world?" And you think, "Actually, I don't want the trouble if they give me a hard time for this." Or there are just times when it costs us financially or reputationally or whatever just to stick to our faith. It'd be so much easier if we could just drop our faith for a few moments. And we have to make a decision. And such decisions, when we make them poorly, can often make us shameful even to the pharaohs of the world, who can see our Christianity as nothing but lip service. When tested, we should challenge ourselves not to be found in want, but like all areas of character, remember that integrity is slow to build and quick to lose. We should fight hard to say that when we say God is my security, we really believe it. And it comes down ultimately to the question, do we believe God's promises and do we trust God? Do you believe that to live according to his rule is going to be the best thing for your life? Do you believe that the fact that God wants what's best for you and doesn't ask you to do things that ultimately aren't for your own benefit? Or are we in charge of what benefits we want? Do we decide when it's time to follow God and when it's time to go our own way? And the reality is that our passage has shown us this evening that it didn't work for Abraham and it won't work for us. It's kind of arrogant, part of it can be arrogance when we think we can do a better job than God can. When we look at God and say, "Yeah, I know your law, I know what you want me to do in this situation, but actually I know a better way, Lord." And so the creation turns to the creator and says, "Yeah, it's not bad, but you can make a few improvements." And yet so often that seems to be how we come to him. So there's a question for us. In these hard times, do we trust God's promises and do we trust God? Secondly, I hope you find some comfort in Abraham. As you think about that, as you think about times when maybe you've compromised, I think of times when I've compromised. And if I could go back in those times, I would love to go back and stick to my guns. And there are other times when I've stuck to my guns and it's gone badly for me, and I'm delighted in the long term that those things happened, because I would rather be in God's favor and out of others than in others' favors and out of God's. But what's wonderful about Abraham is that his failure is a reminder to us that God doesn't choose only perfect people. It would be so easy for Moses, who wrote Genesis, to skip over the bad bits of Abraham and give us this only good presentation of who he was. It would be easy for the gospel writers to give us the best aspects of the disciples and ignore the times when they were failing. This morning we were looking at the unbelief of the Pharisees, but we were seeing the fact that the disciples still didn't get it. And Jesus is getting frustrated at them. Like, do you still not understand? You've got ears, but you don't hear. You've got eyes, but you don't see. And in some ways, you look at those disciples as well, and you get a bit frustrated as well, thinking, have you not worked it out yet? And yet, if you flip it around in a mirror and see the way that you're slow to understand, slow to trust, and slow to believe, you actually take the comfort from the fact that God is well used to our frailty and our weakness and our disobedience. And yet, even in someone like Abraham, for all his failure, God does not stop working through Abraham. His promises stay true to him. He works with us despite our imperfections. If God chose only to work with perfect people, he wouldn't work with any of us here. But instead, God not only works with us, he not only works through us, but he works to make us faithful. Notice that it's God who saves Abraham and Sarah from peril. It's God who makes sure that despite Abraham's unfaithfulness, God is not unfaithful to him. And ultimately we see in Jesus Christ, who chose to take on human flesh, the true reality of a covenant fulfilled. See, when Jesus becomes human, when the Word becomes flesh, he was coming to fulfill both sides of the covenant. He, as God, kept his promise to be our God. And on our behalf, and on behalf of us, he fulfilled the requirements for us to be his people. And so Jesus, knowing all that we would be weak and sinful, just as Abraham was, came in order to justify us through faith to be acceptable to him, so that he could accept us. Can you imagine in that moment when God makes a covenant, actually ultimately with Adam and Eve, but for our text here with Abraham. And when he makes that covenant with Abraham, he knows Abraham can't keep that covenant. And when he makes a covenant with Israel and says, I'll be your God and you will be my people, and you'll remain faithful to me and I'll remain faithful to you. And all we saw in the unfolding of Israel's history is unfaithfulness to God. Almost immediately, within Judges, then they reject God as king. Then they have kings that lead them astray. Then they turn to other outside sources, Egypt again at one point, for help instead of turning to God and trusting in him. And in that moment when God turned to Abraham and said, I will make you into a great nation, he knew well fine that it was going to cost him his son coming to the world to not only be faithful in his part of the contract and covenant, but to fulfill our part as well. So as we come to this communion table shortly, we come to it recognizing that Jesus came fully human so that on our behalf, he could fulfill the covenant. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that incredible? Have you ever made a terrible deal? Isn't that a terrible deal? I'll make a covenant with you. You do both parts. I'll just receive the benefits. What would you say to that? You'd say run and jump. What does God say to that? I'm initiating it. He doesn't wait because we couldn't ask for such a covenant. Instead, he comes and offers, knowing well fine that this was a covenant that on both sides would be fulfilled by God at complete cost to him, at incredible cost to him, immeasurable cost to him, so that we could receive all the benefits of fulfilling the covenant. That's what we come to recognize. And that's what we recognize in God rescuing and restoring Abraham as he returns north, a sign of repentance, as he returns to where he should be. And he does so because he recognized that God has come and stepped in to save him in an incredible way by plagues and by revealing this to Pharaoh. He would choose to take on our sin so that he could accept us into his covenant. You wonder at this point, what attracts us? What attracts God to us at all? And really, it's hard to answer that question, except to say that he's chosen to love us. It's God who makes the covenant. It's God who keeps the covenant. It's God who fulfills the covenant. And it's God who secures the covenant forever. What part do we play? We receive it. As we're going to see, Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. He did not earn his righteousness. Even Pharaoh looks better than him at this point. But it's not about what Abraham did. It's about what Abraham received. As we come to the communion table, we come to recognize that we come here because God has invited us to come. He has made the covenant. That means that we can come. He has kept the covenant, even when we've broken it. He has fulfilled the covenant in his son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross. And he has secured the covenant because it's in Christ and securely in him. It cannot be ruined or damaged or void and nullified. It will never, ever end because of the security we find in Jesus Christ. In response to that, let's have faith as we look at this table, as we look at what God has done. Let's have faith to trust God and trust his promises, to trust that he knows what's best for us in the times of trial, and to recognize that God is the one who fulfills every part of the covenant so that we can have that security. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we have seen last week, the faithfulness of Abraham in response to your call to follow him. Lord, we might relate in our own life of that invitation that you made to come follow you, Lord. And we recognize that invitation to pick up our cross and follow you. But Lord, we also recognize that Abraham, so quickly when famine came his way, was so easily taking his eyes off you, and it led him into chaos. Lord, we pray that you would make us a people who stand firm and secure on your promises. A people who recognize that our character is to reflect your character. Where integrity is slow to build but quick to lose, and yet, Lord, you have never lost it, but you've always been true. And Lord, we pray as we look into Abraham and recognize the fact that you kept working in Abraham's life, and you brought this covenant to its fulfillment, Lord. Having to rescue Abraham and Sarah, having to bring them in the future into everything that you've promised them to have. We recognize it was 100% fulfilled by you and only received to Abraham. Lord, help us to be encouraged at that reality and to step on you, Lord, to trust in you and to believe your promises because you are faithful with them, that we would be a people who stand in the storms knowing that you are our King. We ask these things in your precious and your glorious and your holy name. Amen.
Let's stand to sing these last two songs together. To be in your presence. To rest in your presence, not rushing away, to cherish each moment, here I would stay. This is my desire, oh Lord, this is my desire. This is my desire, oh Lord, this is my desire. This is my desire, oh Lord, this is my desire. This is my desire, oh Lord, this is my desire. How great is our God, the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty.
Splendor of the King.
Be seated. As we come towards the communion table now, we come to remember that God made the covenant. God keeps the promise. He fulfills the covenant and he secures it forever. As I was thinking about that, I was led to Hebrews 9. It says, therefore, he, Jesus, is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. That reality that Jesus is our mediator, that he stands in that gap between us and God, and not only represents God to us, making the invisible visible, but also represents us to God. It is in his name that we approach God's throne. It is in his righteousness, in his obedience, in his goodness that we're able to come into the presence of God. This is a mediator who does much more than just represents one side to the other. He actually does and fulfills the covenant on both sides, so that we can be acceptable to God, accepted by him and into his presence. He is the mediator of this new covenant, this promised eternal inheritance. We've been looking with Abraham at this very idea of promise. And the Hebrew writer reminds us of the promises of God, and it's a promised eternal inheritance. The incredible reality that we come to this table for a time now, when ultimately one day we won't need this table because we will be in the constant presence of Jesus Christ. We will be with him in an inseparable way for eternity. And we're promised too in that same verse that it's thanks to him, a death of Christ, that occurred to redeem us from our transgressions, from our sins. It is our sins that prevent us, our disobedience against God, that prevents us from being able to come into his presence. And God, who is just and holy, refuses to compromise. But he does something else instead. His son comes and dies on the cross. at complete cost to him, based on a promise made long ago that was well null and voided by our own disobedience, but kept by God and then fulfilled by him and now secured by him. The bread represents Christ's body. The wine represents his blood. Nothing was held back on the cross as he lived a perfect life on our behalf and then received the weight of sin. And a holy and perfect God, I cannot imagine what it was for him to take on that which was so opposite to who he was. Not opposite to him, because it wasn't equal to him, but opposite to his nature of righteousness and holiness. Opposite to everything he had been for all eternity. Just so that we could become children of God. This table is wonderful. And it comes to remind us, especially if we're coming like Abraham, recognizing our disobedience, recognizing the place where we haven't trusted his promises or trusted God to be true, and we've tried to do things by our own strength. And this table is a reminder of God's faithfulness to you. For those who know they're not living a way pleasing to him, then this table is a recognition that though you should repent and turn, it is belief that makes us righteous, not our own behavior. A table that takes us in our failure and offers us the answer of hope. And so it's just this table that you're invited to come and to be reminded of God's promise to you, his faithfulness to that promise, his fulfillment of that promise, and the security that promise will never be taken away from you. Because it's held in the words of God, who never lies, who never changes, but is eternally true. Let's have the prayer for the bread and the wine.
Father, we have been challenged tonight from your word, to have faith and to believe in the promises of God. And Father, this table that we see laid before us here speaks about the promises of God. I think back into the Old Testament when the Messiah, Jesus, was promised, and into the New Testament when Jesus, the Messiah, came and lived amongst us. But around this table, we want to remember that he also went to that cross for each and every one of us. And there is a promise there that if we put our trust and believe in the name of Jesus, then we will be saved. We will have eternal life. Mm. What a promise. And we believe tonight, Father, that it was a gift. We could not earn it. It was a complete gift. It's all of grace. And so, Father, tonight, as we often think, I pray that not one of us are here tonight just out of habit, but out of a generous desire, Father, to be here around this table, because it's an act of obedience. This do in memory of me. And so we gather tonight and we give you thanks, Father, for the Lord Jesus Christ. We give you thanks, Father, that he went willingly to that cross of Calvary for each and every one of us. And so we give you thanks for this bread that represents that broken body, that body that was torn and ripped and nailed to the cross. We give thanks, Father, for this cup that represents that wine, the wine that represents that outpoured blood that was shed, freely shed for each and every one of us. Jesus knew what lay before him, even in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he sweat tears of blood. Father, we just praise you and we thank you again tonight for Jesus and for what he has done for us and for what he means to each and every one of us. We thank you again for Jesus. Amen.
Paul, speaking to the church in Corinth, says, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he's betrayed, he took bread, and when he gave him thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We'll take the bread as we receive it. The same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We'll hold on to the cup and take them together as a reminder of our unity together in Christ. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's close our service in prayer together. Our Lord and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for coming to this table to be reminded of your covenant with us, fulfilled and secured in you. We thank you for the reminder of that promise of eternal life, that promised eternal inheritance, that promise that Christ's death has redeemed us from our sins, and that even now, your Son, Jesus Christ, is mediating on our behalf. We thank you that his representation is not just to speak fondly of us, but to actually represent us with his life, which has fulfilled all that we were called to fulfill and yet failed. And yet, even despite our failure, you have made us a success. You have given us your victory so that we can come to you in prayer like we are, come into your presence boldly knowing that you will receive us as you receive your Son, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we lift up before you those who need to know your presence in a powerful way. We think of the reminder that we've had that being a Christian doesn't take us away from difficult circumstances, but in fact, it gives us the very strength to be able to endure them. We think of those who are grieving at this time, for those who are experiencing illness, for those who are experiencing a loss of some kind. Lord, even just in the silence in our own hearts, we bring them before you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the God of all circumstances, and we pray that in our suffering and in our grief, you would, in a special way, make your presence known to us. We thank you for your promises to us, Lord, and we pray that we would go as a people in faith. Lord, I pray that we would become notorious for our faith in you, not because it makes us well known, but in order to glorify your name. And we pray this week ahead for all the circumstances that we might go into and face, that we would take every opportunity to trust you above anything else, to stand on your promises above anything else, Lord. And we pray that you would give us the courage and the faith to act in these circumstances as you would act in our circumstances, in honor of you and in the glory of you. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.